And yeah, I'm happy to be here and tell you about our work on GraalVM and with a focus on static analysis. So who am I? I have been working on GraalVM more or less for the last decade. And it really started out as kind of as a research project within Oracle Labs. And we slowly brought it from research to production. And I want to talk a little bit about this journey today. But first of all, the usual introduction. What really is GraalVM? And actually, it's a bit of the problem that GraalVM is actually three different things. And at first, GraalVM is really just another just-in-time compiler for the Java Hotspot VM. We just switch out the server compiler from the Java Hotspot VM and replace it with the GraalVM compiler. And you get better peak performance when you run your Java application on a Java Hotspot VM, but not much else changes. The second part of GraalVM is the head of time compilation native image. That's what we are mostly talking about today. So here you take your Java application, you run it through a native image generator, and you get the standalone binary out of that. And the third angle is like, we have a multi-language framework that's what's called Truffle, and we have many different languages implemented on top of that framework, from JavaScript, Ruby, Python to lower-level languages like WebAssembly and also LLVM and Bitcoin. Now you could ask, of course, well, why would we have three things under the same name? Is it just to make marketing and sales unhappy so that they have to distinguish these three things under the same name? Not really, because they all really have one very large shared component, and that is the GraalVM compiler. And the same compiler that is giving you good performance for JIT compilation gives you AOT compilation and also the multi-language support. So to illustrate that, you really have this one compiler. And when you run it, your application on the Java Hotspot VM with GraalVM compiler is a JIT compiler. As I said, not much changes. It's like your application just runs, is just in time compiled. In the second configuration, and then you have Truffle languages, and it can be, as I said, JavaScript, but it can be Ruby or Python or any other language. Then the same compiler that runs in the Java Hotspot VM and compiles Java bytecode just in time also compiles JavaScript and Ruby and Python code just in time. That is, of course, a completely separate multi-hour talk how all of that works in the Truffle framework. But it's really nice because it's like the compiler is really language independent and it uses partial evaluation to optimize the higher level dynamic languages. But in the end, it's the same compiler, just with a little different configuration. Now, when you look at the native image generator, then we actually use the GraalVM compiler in two different ways, even just to do the native image generation. At first, we use it for static analysis. So in order to do static analysis, you need to pass your bytecode and then bring it in a form that the static analysis can run on that. And all of that is taken care of by the compiler. And then after the static analysis finishes, and then we have analysis results that the static analysis was proving. And then we run the head of time compilation, and the GraalVM compiler is just configured for ahead of time instead of just-in-time compilation, and it gives you a standalone binary for your application. Of course, the native image generator itself is just a regular Java application that runs on the Java Hotspot VM. So while you're doing ahead of time compilation, the same compiler is actually also running as a JIT compiler and just-in-time compiling the native image generator. So in that case, the GraalVM compiler is actually just in time compiling itself so that it can do ahead of time compilation. And then in the previous slide I had, well, you can run our Truffle languages on the GraalVM compiler, but of course the whole thing is quite nicely composable. So you can now take these Truffle languages and actually put them into a native image. So what you get now is that you get a native image that again contains the GraalVM compiler as a just-in-time compiler. And then you get a standalone binary that already has the compiler built in. And when you at runtime do just-in-time compilation of a JavaScript application, it works again as expected. So now you have the really nice thing that you have the JIT compiler of the Java Hotspot VM just in time compiling the same compiler so that it can do faster ahead of time compilation. And it's ahead of time compiling the same compiler so that it can put this compiled code into the native image itself. So it's like all of that going on at the same time. And by now it should be clear that that only works because the GraalVM compiler is really designed from the ground up to do that, to be a virtual machine independent and to be highly configurable and extensible. So all of that is made possible because the maturity of the compiler is just a VM independent, can be reused, and then you just configure how to do certain things. Again, how out of that works is a completely separate talk and paper, but if you're interested in it, we published that a few years ago. It's like under the hood, it's like you actually write all these higher level semantics, like how do I do object allocation in my virtual machine? How I do type checks? How do I do synchronization? You actually write that in the form of snippets in kind of a low level dialect of Java. And so you can express these configurations quite nicely in Java itself. And that way, yeah. We were able to kind of reuse the same technology for many different angles. But now to go into the details, what I really want to talk about today is really GraalVM native image itself. And we'll start with a little bit of general introduction. What's the real programming model, the differentiator of GraalVM native image compared to other ahead of time compilation strategies? And then we'll go into the details of static analysis. So that's the one slide overview. How does GraalVM native image work? The input is, of course, your application, so any kind of Java classes. And I say really Java class, but of course, Java classes means it can be produced from Java source code, from Scala source code, from Kotlin source code, so whenever. Whichever language you have that compiles to Java bytecode. You have all your libraries. You have the JDK itself, which is quite a big amount of class files. And then you have a kind of reused virtual machine that we call Substrate VM, which is also written in Java itself. So we took a lot of prior experience that was actually came. We did the Maxine VM previously, a virtual machine written in Java. There has, of course, been the JIX RVM for a long time. So it's like there has been a long history of writing Java VMs in Java. And so Substrate VM is inspired by that. It's a quite reduced minimal runtime environment that provides the usual thing like thread support, logging support, garbage collection, all of that written in Java. So you have a large amount of Java classes. We know all of these classes ahead of time. So it's like there's a closed world assumption that really all bytecodes are known ahead of time. And with all the bytecodes known and the entry point of your application known, you can now run a pretty aggressive static analysis that finds out what parts of the classes, the which methods, which fields are actually reachable. And that's currently done using a points to analysis. But that's not all what's going on, because Java is really a language that you can not overly well ahead of time compile just by compiling code, because Java is very object-oriented and data-driven. So in order to effectively optimize and ahead of time compile Java code, you actually need data. So you need already Java objects that were created. And for that, you actually need to run some initializations of your application and really run some code already at this image build time. And as soon as you run code and you create Java objects, you need to capture them somehow and make sure that you have these objects already available then at runtime when your application starts up. And that's what's done by heap snapshotting, that really finds out also which objects are reachable, and then can put these objects into the final output native executable. And so once the points to analysis has reached a fixed point, and all this iteration has reached a fixed point, then you know all your methods that are reachable, and you can ahead of time compile those. And you also know which initializations have run and which objects were created, and you snapshot those and you write those out into the image heap. And that means in the final executable, when you look at really from the low-level ELF or MachO or Windows exit point of view, what's in the binary, there's a pretty big text section, of course, with all your compiled code. But there's also a pretty big data section, which contains the image heap. And this data section is really in the then when new objects are allocated at runtime. So it's like when the execution starts at runtime, this image heap is just memory mapped into your address space and kind of forms the initial heap then, and all the objects that you allocate at runtime just get added to this heap. So when you start up your application then at runtime, you already start up a pretty well pre-initialized application that has a considerably large heap. And that makes then the startup at runtime really much faster, because you don't need to run through all the initialization steps again from scratch. So how far do you put this? And it's like, how much of your application do you want to initialize? Well, that's really up to you. There are some pretty basic things that can always be initialized, even if you don't configure anything manually. Then it's like, we of course have the static analysis results, and we know certain initializers in Java kind of are side effect free, and we run them automatically for you. So for those of you who are quite familiar with Java, then I'm sure you know that a Java enumeration, so the enums, are actually in Java modeled as classes and singleton objects. So when you have a Java enum, then you actually have a class. And for each enum value, you have an object. And normally behave enums are, of course, side effect free. So because they are just kind of marker objects and not really objects that encapsulate the real value. And so allocating them is side effect free. So all of these allocations happen already at image build time, which means when you use a Java enum at runtime, then all of these enum values are already there and you don't need to allocate them. Versus if you run your application on the Java hotspot VM and you use an enum the first time, the class initializer of enum runs and, well, it allocates 10, 15 objects. You have an enum with 10 or 15 values. And all of these initialization time is saved because we run off that code really already at build time. So for that, as I said, you definitely need a closed world assumption, because otherwise aggressive AOT optimizations are just not possible. So the only real restriction that GraalVM native image has is like, you cannot add a new bytecode at runtime. So whatever bytecode, whatever class files are there, they need to be known at build time. There are lots of other dynamic parts of Java, like reflection, GNI, Java lang proxy, that are dynamic and they can be implemented and are implemented like on the Java hotspot VM with bytecode generation at runtime. But we support them in a different way by just configuring them also at image build time. Unfortunately, it's not really feasible from a footprint point of view in Java to just say, well, every method can be invoked via reflection, that we also allow at image runtime to invoke every method via reflection, because that would again kind of make any kind of points to analysis useless. Because if any kind of method of invoke, and there are lots of them, can invoke any method that you have in your application, you more or less end up with a fully connected call graph where every method can call every other method. And it's like, well, no point to try to optimize anything. But if you have a reasonable application where you just need a few methods that are invoked by a reflection, then you configure these few methods at image build time. You really explicitly list them, and then these methods you can, as expected, normally invoke by a reflection. And the same for JNI, where you can invoke methods and Javelin proxy and resources. All of this stuff needs to be configured at image build time. But if you are willing to take these restrictions, then, as I said, you get much better and much faster startup times. I already said all about the image heap, but to illustrate that, it's like to come back to the point, well, what do you really want to have in your image heap? And it's like, we don't put any limits on that. But first, to go back without query and native image, of course, you compile your source code at build time, but everything else happens always at runtime. So it's like a Java Hotspot VM, first loads all classes, and then assume you have kind of a little microservice that is configured by a service configuration file. Then you load this configuration file, you set up all of your network endpoints, all of that, and then you run your microservice. When you run your application as a native image without doing anything out of the box, then definitely all the class loading always happens at image build time. As I said, all classes are known at image build time, so they are loaded, and all methods that are reachable are ahead of time compiled. And for certain class initializers that are proven to be side effect free, then that code also runs already at image build time, but we can do that because, well, you cannot observe a side effect, so we are free to do that. But out of the box, of course, we cannot load your application configuration file, because only you as the application developer know, well, is this really a configuration file that you configure to be reasonably stable, like a service configuration file? Or is this really a file that is the application input that is going to be processed? But if you have a service configuration and you know your service configuration file is kind of a constant, then you can load this service configuration file already at build time and configure kind of your whole microservice or your whole command line application or whatever application you're running. And you just run this code at image build time. It usually allocates quite a good bunch of objects. And all of these objects are just snapshotted and put in the image heap. And then these configuration objects are automatically there at runtime, and you don't need to load and initialize things at runtime. So with that, the summary is like, you as the application developer now have complete freedom how much of your application initialization you actually want to run at image build time, and which things should remain configurable at runtime, and this configuration, then you just load normally at runtime. We don't give you many restrictions, but you need to know what you're doing. Because obviously, if you do things wrongly, and there's not, unfortunately, not much we can do to prevent that, is like you can easily kind of bake in some state from your build machine into the final executable. It's like if you somehow, when loading this configuration, you bake in the username into a Java string, then, well, the username of your build configuration is available or is baked into the executable. So you need to be careful and know what you're doing. But when you are careful, it's a very powerful approach. All of that worked out nicely in research. And like we wrote a nice paper about that more or less evaluates it in the usual, well, that's your startup of Hello World and with some, oh, Hello World with some configuration from a JSON file. But of course, the real then a question is, well, does it really work in practice? And fortunately, by now I can say, yes, it really works in practice too. And that's actually something that a lot of Java developers and especially Java framework developers were really looking forward to. And because when we actually went public with GraalVM native image, there have been already a good number of efforts, like Micronaut as a microservice framework has been around before, and Red Hat was already working on Quarkus, and Oracle was already working on Helidon. So all of these companies were already working on kind of new a new crop of Java frameworks that actually had the goal of reducing these large startup times and be suitable for microservices. Because if you go now back, you can say 5 years, how did people deploy their Java applications? Well, you had your large JBoss WebLogic server running, and then, well, you drop in a new web application file into your already big running server. And then, well, all of that got picked up automatically. But restarting your application server, well, it takes half an hour until that server is really warmed up. And that does not really work with microservices, because it's like if your microservice takes half an hour to start up, it's really not possible. So with this new microservice frameworks, it definitely got the startup also on the Java Hotspot VM down to the order of seconds, which is clearly an improvement, because instead of half an hour, it only takes seconds. But seconds is still pretty long, especially when you want to rapidly scale out on a large cloud deployment. So when you just now take your application and build and make a native image out of it, then without doing anything and without doing any configuration, then you already get down your seconds to kind of hundreds of milliseconds of startup time. Because it's like you automatically lose all the time that's necessary for class loading and just-in-time compilation of the hotspot VM. But you're down to hundreds of milliseconds of startup time. But still, there's hundreds of milliseconds is still pretty long. And then you, how to get that further down? And that's exactly what the frameworks are now doing, like Quarkus. And I have one very nice tweet from Micronaut. It's like, you actually, they are really doing that. They are parsing their configuration files already at image build time and baking in the configuration into the native image. And then you really get down to this, in that case, 6 milliseconds of startup time for a fully initialized and configured microservice framework. So it's like in these six milliseconds, it's like you're really ready to accept your first request. And that's pretty impressive. So it's like, it's nice to see that what we originally started out as research really turned out to be very useful in production. And people were really looking forward to a system like that. So now you can say, well, what's so special about native image? And why not just do ahead of time compilation of Java? And if you look at the history for Java, ahead of time compilation has been around for quite a while. So there has been the very early days, the GCC had the GCJ kind of configuration. Like, well, if you have a compiler that can compile C code and C++ code, well, you can repurpose such a compiler to also ahead of time compile Java code. And there have been other specialized projects like the Excelsior Jet and JAOTC, which was part of OpenJDK and actually using a GraalVM compiler completely separately from native image also as an ahead of time compiler. But the problem with all of these pure AOT compilation solution is that, as I said, they're just compiling and they're completely missing out on the data part. And because Java is object oriented and HOS has all this little objects like these enum objects, it's like your AOT compiled code quality is just really bad. And yes, with something like JAOTC, it was designed as, well, kind of this middle ground. You get a little better startup because you save some just-in-time compilation during startup. But then in the end, your AOT compiled code quality is not good enough to really be suitable for peak performance. So it's like in the end, then you need to just in time compile anyway. So it's like you have this hybrid thing of doing a little bit EOT and a little bit JIT compilation. But with native image, we decided, well, we go all in and we really want to do 100% EOT compilation and get good JIT performance out of that. And for that, you really need to compile code and already have objects available at image build time. And then you get the system that we ended up with exactly, which is like the text section with code and the data section with the image heap. Yeah, that was kind of the big picture of RealVM native image. By the way, if there are any questions, just unmute yourself or ask in the various different chats. We can address them now, or we can talk about any questions at the end. Now, in the second half of the talk, I want to go into kind of the details. How do we really do static analysis now for GraalVM native image? And static analysis is, of course, a very well studied topic. It's like, well, the whole conference is about that. So it's like there's no shortage of literature. But when you look at the existing static analysis frameworks for Java, they're always kind of self-contained and isolated, which means it's like someone sat down to write a static analysis framework. And of course, to analyze Java's bytecode, first you need to start with a class file parser and a bytecode parser and write that. And you pass that into kind of a higher level intermediate representation, usually in SSA form. And then after you have done all of that, then you can actually write your actual static analysis algorithms. And analysis frameworks like Zoot, for example, work exactly like that. But we want to take advantage, of course, of our GraalVM compiler infrastructure and not write all of this stuff again, because every code that I need to write is, well, is code that I need to maintain later and don't want to do that. So what we are doing in GraalVM native image is actually we are reusing the Java hotspot VM to do all the class loading and all the difficult parts of kind of the Java type system for us. And as part of the GraalVM project, we introduced this JVM compiler interface, also called JVMCI, which is a Java level interface that's now built into the Java hotspot VM. And with that, any kind of Java application can access details about classes and methods and bytecodes. So for example, one thing you can ask JVMCI is like, well, give me the bytecodes of a method. And to do that, the Java hotspot VM is loading the class file, parsing the class file, parsing the constant pool, all of that, and then really giving you the bytecodes of the method as a byte array and the constant pool entries for that method as a nice Java abstraction of a constant pool. But JVMCI and the Java Hotspot VM, of course, also know everything about the type hierarchy, about type checks, and also everything about how to resolve, for example, Java virtual method calls. Because even though it looks simple at first, but if you really go into the details of the specification, really figuring out which method should be invoked if you have an abstract or an interface method that is invoked and a certain concrete object as the receiver, that's not really trivial. Because in Java, now you have all these things, like you have interfaces with default methods, you have all the visibility things. It's like if you have a package private methods, then it's like if you overwrite it in the same package, then the overwritten method should be called. But if you overwrite it in a class in a different package, then it's like a separate method and it's not a real override. So all of these things we did not want to implement and we did not need to implement because JVMCI exposes all of that for us. And then for bytecode parsing, of course, we already have the compiler front end of the GraalVM compiler that we can reuse. So it's like when you look at what happens in the static analysis for GraalVM native image, then it's actually a really simple piece of code because it uses JVM CI and it uses the GraalVM compiler frontend to pass all the bytecodes, all the classes into the GraalVM intermediate representation, which is a pretty high level IR in SSA form. And then the only thing we need to do is like do run a static analysis already on this high level IR. The nice thing about the Graal IR is like it really is high level, so it's like you still have no one node for its like object allocation. And it's not like that is already kind of a lower thing. It's like, oh, how to do that in detail? No, it's one node for doing object allocation. It's one node for doing an array access that is not lowered yet to, oh, first you need to do a bounce check and a null check. So it really is a nice high level IR. So, and then with that, it was actually pretty easy to just implement our own points two analysis from scratch. And just to illustrate what's going on, it's like I have a little example. It has a method foo that calls a method allocate and a method bar. And just to make things a little more fun, the allocate method actually stores a new object in a field, and the bar method then invokes the standard hashcode method on it. So after parsing the things in the Graal IR, we construct what we call the type flow graph, which is really just a directed graph how types flow through your application. The sources are allocations. Like when you have this new point allocation, then we know there's the precise type point flowing out of that. The type flows into the put field node, and put field means, well, there's a type state for which types can that field has. So the type is propagated down into the state of this field. And then that means every get field of this field also gets this type. So the type is flowing out, it's flowing into the receiver of the hashcode call. And then there's a virtual call, which now can be nicely analyzed by the static analysis because we know we have a virtual call of a hashcode method. The concrete type flowing in is a point instance. And so that method is resolved by the static analysis to point.hashcode. And in this case, the static analysis has proven that this virtual call actually is a direct call that can only reach point.hashcode. This analysis is context insensitive. What does that mean? When you introduce some other code that actually stores a different type into the field, so imagine there's some other method that now stores a string into this field F, and then now also the type string can reach the, as a receiver type, the virtual call site. So the static analysis sees this second type, it resolves the virtual call to a second method, and now you actually have the information that this hashcode method can now actually have two concrete methods at runtime, so it really remains a virtual call at runtime. Which means because the static analysis is context insensitive in that case, it's fairly imprecise, which always surprises people a little bit because it's like there are so many things that we as a developer easily see, oh, this cannot happen, but the static analysis just doesn't see it. So even though in this case, we as a developer would easily see that bar can still only get the type point because after all, the object is just allocated in the line above the call to bar, the static analysis doesn't know that. But that's fine. It's still good enough. But then it's like, as I said, there are tons of conferences on static analysis. So in theory, it's of course very easy to improve the precision of the analysis. And because how do you make a context insensitive analysis, static analysis more precise? Well, you make the analysis a context sensitive. And there are all these different kinds of things that you can use as the context. You can use a method invocation context. So it's like, oh, if foo calls bar, then it's like you analyze bar in the context of foo. Or you use a heap context, which means you analyze the call of bar in the context of the allocate, the method that allocated your receiver. which for Java actually is usually considered to be much better than a method context. But what we learned kind of the hard way is that all of that is nice in theory, but any useful improvement of precision in Java requires a very deep context, because Java has very deep call chains. So it's like if you have a context sensitivity of just two or three levels of method context, doesn't buy you anything in Java, because it's like you always have these two or three levels of helper methods. If you use a heap context, things are a little bit better, but I have the next slide, just a simple example of a Java util hash map. And it's like, well, you need a three level deep heap context, otherwise you don't get anything. And then the real problem in Java is actually arrays, because Java arrays have in effect no type information at all, because regardless of what array you have, you can always cast it to an object array, which means from a static analysis point of view, the bottom line is anything that ever gets stored into any array can flow out of any other excess of an array, and there's just no way to disintegrate that. And reflection is pervasively used. And since reflection actually passes arguments in object arrays, you have the same thing again. It's like, well, at some point, kind of every type that is ever allocated in your application somehow ends up in an object array. So every array read can actually get every error instantiated type out. And then you have all these nasty JDK methods like string.format. That's like the whole world is reachable, because it's like string.format. It's like uses localization, it uses charset format. So it's like kind of everything that's in the JDK, in the Java base module, is reachable from string.format. Now you could say, well, do I care about that? Unfortunately, yes, because half of the exception constructors in Java use string.format to format the exception message. So it's like now you have, well, every place that can throw an exception calls string.format, and which means you have tons of places actually, even in your Hello World application in Java, that makes string.format reachable. So somehow we came to the conclusion that at least for now, context-sensitive analysis is not really feasible in production. And I am not making a general claim here that it's completely impossible ever, but my data point is we tried and we failed. And I have actually one example here. Let's go to that first. What we tried, for example, is to do kind of a region-based memory management on top of a context-sensitive static analysis. It sounds nice, especially if you have, for example, a compiler. You can easily say, well, everything that's allocated in this while doing compilation, you can actually free without the garbage collection, because you know no temporary object of a compiler kind of survives compilation. And it's again, it's nice in theory, and we got a good paper out of it. But then in the end, can you use it in production? Not really, because yes, all of these places in the compiler call string.format, and string.format initializes global caches. It's like you have so many places where you then need to have some sort of a manual interaction and say, well, if I call this method, then well, exit my region, and it's not really region-based memory management. Then it like turned out to be not really useful and not really feasible in production. But to come back to this, why is context sensitivity in Java so expensive? And it's like you just need to look at a hash map. And hash map is more or less the building block kind of everything. But in Java, a hash map is, of course, a three-level deep structure, because you have the hash map object. Then you have an array that stores nodes. Remember what I said about arrays? Already getting in trouble here. And then in the array, you actually have two different kinds of nodes, because of course you can have a node that is just a linked list with an overflow list of when your hash bucket overflows. But then someone got creative in Java and said, well, this list can get too long, and well, we can do a binary tree to optimize that. So you actually have two kinds of nodes, and you have a linked list of an arbitrary length, or you can have a binary tree of an arbitrary depth. And then you finally get to your keys and values that you store into your hash map. So the bottom line is, if you analyze your hash map with anything less than a three-level deep heap context, you're absolutely not gaining anything, because you can still not disambiguate between two different hash maps. And that's the thing that you want. You want to say, well, things that are put into this one hash map cannot come out of this other hash map. So is everything lost? Actually, not really. Everything is lost from a point of view. You cannot just use a normal context-sensitive analysis to analyze things like hash map. But you need to do some special things again. And one very nice thing, actually, is semantic models. And it's something that came out of a research idea from Carnegie Mellon University. And then we had an intern who actually kind of implemented that for native image. And the really simple idea, and it's like, well, why didn't I have that idea myself? It's like, in order to do a kind of context-sensitive analysis of a hash map, no one cares about these three-level deep object structures. Because it's like, from the point of view of the static analysis, a hash map is more or less, well, you put something in, and everything that you put into a particular hash map, you can get out. So what I have on the right here, which we call the semantic model of a hash map, is actually everything that the static analysis needs to know about the hash map. And it really is like that. In the put method, you say, well, everything that you put in, you kind of accumulate in my key field, which is not a functional thing. So of course, that's not a functional hash map that you could ever execute. But the static analysis doesn't care, because the static analysis now sees, well, all the keys, all the values that get put in into this hash map get accumulated into in a kind of a type state for the all keys and all values, and the get method just returns this. And now, when you have such a semantic model, now context-sensitive analysis has a chance again, because now all you need is actually a one-level deep heap context for this kind of hash map model class. And the nice thing is, context-sensitive analysis does not get out of control, because the methods that are analyzed in the context-sensitive way are very short. It's like the input method is like two field stores and one field load. The get method is one field load. So you can really now aggressively do context-sensitive analysis and clone all of these put and get methods in every context without things getting out of control. So that worked out really nicely. And some performance analysis of that paper is like, if blue is our baseline with context insensitive analysis, and red is just the overhead in terms of how many X slowdown do you have when you enable context sensitive analysis just for a hash map and other collection classes. So not even for everything, just for the collection classes. And you see, for small benchmarks, well, you're still in the area where you can at least measure it with a 4x, with a 10x slowdown, or a 100x slowdown. But for anything remotely realistic, like the Helidon, Micronaut, or Quarkus microservice frameworks, you cannot really even benchmark it. And I think our timeout was something like a few hours. And it's like, if I cannot run a static analysis in a few hours, well, it's not really useful for anything in production. But with a semantic model, you only get now into 20, 30% slowdown. And that's something that you can do if you want to. Unfortunately, like with many internships, it's like we got all the static analysis part working and it works out nicely, but then we never took advantage of that in the real compilation. So for now, that remains as a exercise to the reader to, well, really implement it in production. But at least we have some confidence if we ever need to increase precision, then yeah, that's the way to go. But then in the end, in the last 2 or 3 years, I actually needed to take my researcher hat off and put my production hat on in the sense that when you look at what people were doing, no one was ever complaining about the position of our context-insensitive static analysis. Because in the end, it's just good enough. But what people complain a lot about is the time it takes to run the static analysis and the memory footprint of that. And yes, when you then have these things out on GitHub and people start using it, then you get these GitHub issues like, well, I cannot build an image on my Raspberry Pi, which has 2 gigabytes of memory. And it's like, that's what people want to do. No one has asked me on GitHub to implement the context-sensitive static analysis, but lots of people have asked me, well, can I run this on my Raspberry Pi? So that's why actually in the last years, we really worked a lot to make the static analysis actually faster by sacrificing a little bit of precision, but not too much, because of course you don't want to get too imprecise. And one thing, for example, what we implemented is what we call saturated type states. It's like a very simple idea. The points to analysis in the end gives you very precise type states and say, well, at this variable can have this 560 types can reach this point. But from an optimization point of view, it makes no difference if you know that this variable can be reached by 560 or 570 types. The only thing that matters really is, well, is it one type or is it zero? That actually is really important. Is it zero? Is it one? Is it two or three? Because then you can do still some polymorphic inlining. But everything more than 10, no one ever cares. So we just made our point two analysis a little more imprecise and cut out all the type states by something like 10. And everything that's bigger than 10 is like, can be anything. Had no real measurable impact on the precision, but a huge impact on scalability, because with some synthetic benchmarks, before that you couldn't even compile something with more than 2,000 or 3,000 classes that had lots of virtual calls, because you got this quadratic behavior. And by cutting it off, everything scales linearly. And that's what really what made the whole thing then feasible. But then it's like still, I was actually not telling the complete truth when I'm saying people were not caring about precision. People were just caring about precision, but for other things. Not for things like, oh, what can come out of my hash map? But what people really care about is actually kind of constant folding that happens already at image build time. And remember, it's like, well, we have our image heap, and it's like, when you have constants that are embedded, well, of course you can do constant folding when you have a final field already actually before the static analysis runs. But it only works nicely if you kind of have a static field that is final and accessed directly. So top part here of my example is like, if someone has like a static final field windows, and if you check this field directly, then the static analysis, or actually before the static analysis, this value is already constant folded, and the static analysis doesn't even see the other method. So it's like, if windows is true, the static analysis doesn't even ever see a call to bar, because, well, it got already constant folded away before. But as soon as you put this thing into a method call, then the static analysis now cannot no longer see through that, because it's like, well, that's a method call, everything can happen, and now foo and bar are reachable. So what we implemented now, and actually that is really helpful, is actually to do already method inlining before the static analysis runs to inline such small methods. So it's like we are reusing the compiler and compiler optimization phases that we have to already optimize the input to the static analysis. And since then the input to the static analysis is already a little bit pre-optimized by the compiler optimizations, the static analysis actually gives you quite a good precision boost. And for example, this inlining before static analysis is now enabled by default in GraalVM. And I can really say that now, because GraalVM 21.3 was released 4 hours ago. So right now, when you download it, you already get it. So in the end, if you generalize that, it's like there's actually a good number of compiler optimization phases that are worth running before the static analysis. I already talked about constant folding, which in our system kind of happens automatically because already during bytecode parsing, if there's a static final field, it gets constant folded. And if you load another field from a final field, it gets constant folded. So it's like we didn't need to implement anything for that because the bytecode parser already does that. But the fact that we use a bytecode parser from a compiler and not a bytecode parser from a static analysis framework more or less gave us that for free. And then you run that code elimination that eliminates dead branches. Method inlining is highly effective. But then there are also other things like conditional elimination. It's like, well, if the compiler can already prove away some conditions, well, by just looking at one method, there's no point in bothering a static analysis with that. So actually makes, when you run that phase, it makes your static analysis faster. But then there are even surprising phases like escape analysis. You wouldn't expect that escape analysis, running it before static analysis, makes the static analysis more precise. But it is, because that escape analysis enables then, again, more method inlining and more constant folding. You just need to look at certain Java idioms. It's like, oh, if you call class.getDeclared method and it has a variable argument list, then actually, unfortunately, and Java semantic means var args actually arrays. So what you get in your bytecode is actually an array allocation with an array initialization. But it's pretty simple. You run escape analysis. Escape analysis can easily virtualize this combined array allocation and initialization. And then you can easily prove that, well, all the parameters to get declared method are now compile time constants, and I can constant fold the whole lookup of this method. So it's like, yeah, summaries, there are lots of compiler optimization phases that are actually pretty good in making your static analysis more precise. And then actually you don't really need a context-sensitive analysis because you're already getting the precision you need out of a context-insensitive analysis. One last point, I already said that, well, your application initialization runs at image build time and you can run whatever code you want. But the real nice thing is like you can run code that actually reacts to static analysis results. So you can actually register reachability handlers and say, well, if this type is really reachable or if this method is reachable, then I do some different initialization. And that's really convenient for libraries and frameworks because now you can actually write the framework that at image build time reacts to how the user uses your framework. So it's like if you have a large framework like Micronaut or Quarkus, then it's like you can do many things with it, but in reality, every single application only does one or two things with it. And by reacting to reachability results, you can actually, the framework can optimize itself better and customize itself to the actual use cases and usage in a particular application. So the framework can, for example, say, well, if this method is not reachable at all, then I do not need to configure all of my, for example, cryptography stuff, because it's like I only need to configure that when really someone says, well, HTTPS kind of is reachable. And as long as the HTTPS code is not reachable, well, I can skip all of that kind of configuration. And that's a really nice API, what I think, and that really makes an application kind of participate in the static analysis. And I hope that that will be something that in the future actually can be really useful then too for these frameworks to actually optimize applications even more and really get to applications that start up even faster and that are even smaller because unnecessary parts are just then not seen as reachable. Yeah, that's more or less all that I had. In summary, what we have right now with Bralvium native image is like a context insensitive points to analysis. We converged to that via trial and error because everything else we tried did not really work. But what really works is this image heap scanning and running application code already during static analysis and reacts to reachability information. And now that we have a context insensitive analysis that scales pretty well, we're actually making it more precise by running more and more compiler phases before the static analysis and kind of gaining the precision we need that way. And method inlining is really the thing that helped us here the most. Yeah, that's all from my side. If that's there, any questions?